Hey guys, welcome on back to the New Star Cup here with me, Gorgon the Wonder Cow, and of course, Toffees and Phage. Just bringing it back to you guys here. It's the middle of the night for us, so if we start to lag out a little bit, that is why. Not computers-wise, but brains-wise. So, Toffees, coming back in game number two. How you feeling? You going strong?
I'm going strong. Hey, I took a short nap after softball, so I got 3 hours in, and I'm feeling fresh, so we should be good. I'm more worried about work this afternoon, but we'll deal with that when the time comes. That said, though, it looks like that last game, man, DK did some great work. LGD had a solid early draft. I think they had a good answer for what they knew DK was cooking, but they just weren't able to kick the tires and light the fires fast enough to deal with what DK had going.
Yeah, it is more than kicking tires and starting fires. They absolutely had to just throw the nitrous down. They did not have enough time in that game to plausibly beat DK. The Naga Siren got going like 33% faster than a normal Naga Siren would get going. And that is, of course, burning for you. And LGD once again going to ban out that Enchantress just to make sure that it does not get into the hands of DK. And they're going to pick up the Naga Siren to fuse it to burning as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good choice. We saw that burning Naga Siren was about 7 minutes ahead of the curve. And that's something that C-Deck just could not deal with. You want to stop the Naga Siren, but when Naga has that much power, and not only was he 7 minutes ahead of the curve, he got picked off as well. And he got harassed a little bit. Not as much as they would have liked, but still, it wasn't like he had free farm the entire time. It's not like he wasn't picked off. And he still came to the game, said, "I don't care what you do to me. I'm going to get this Radiance up and running faster than you can even imagine."
Yeah, good luck stopping me, is basically.
Exactly.
And they rotated it on him like twice, but it was not nearly enough attention on him. But then again, if you focus entirely on the Naga Siren, then you're not going to be focusing there on that Queen of Pain, who was also a very serious component of that victory.
Absolutely. So Lion picked up to go out with that Mirana. Interesting. You don't see as much Lion played nowadays, so that'll be fun. I think that Hex is going to be valuable for them, as well as the potential for multi-hero stuns. And one of the problems that they had in the last game, I thought that DK did really well, but there was a couple in the early ganks that just didn't pan out because maybe they didn't have enough follow-up damage looking at that 8-9 minute mark. Finger is going to fix that for him.
Yeah, so DK grabbing that Lion, which was, I will point out, that was a banned hero last game because DK plays a little bit more than average in the meta, and I assume Phage Guy can help us out here, but I assume that he's been played a little bit more as of late, like the last couple games, maybe games earlier in this series. Not 100%, or not this series, but this tournament. I'm not 100% sure because Chinese Dota goes on when I'm normally sleeping, as is the case for you. So I try to keep up with it as much as I can, but both of us are more North American European guys, I think. So I do a little bit of Southeast Asia as well. But
yeah, I think it's absolutely true. I mean, we tend to sleep during Chinese Dota for the most part, especially during that last 20 minutes of farming. But what we see is...
in general, but you can take it that way too, I guess.
The thing that I think is really troublesome or hard for C-Deck to deal with is the fact that they have to burn their second ban on Enchantress. She's just so strong in the hands of Lanham that they can't allow it to go through, which means that they really, by doing that, can allow DK to dictate the pace of the draft. Anytime that you have to ban out of respect, it means that it gives an advantage to the opposing team in a lot of ways. Yeah. So, yeah, it looks like Phage just came through and said that they are 6-2 with the Lion this month, played both by MY and Lanham. So he is a multifunctional hero for these two guys that have the ability to kind of switch back and forth depending on what the 4-5 is needed.
All right, so we are coming in here. Some additional bans being dropped out. The Doombringer was an interesting ban by DK. Obviously a hero who is more than in the meta, especially in Asia. And a hero who does very well against the Mirana, so I can see why they wouldn't want him out there. The Enigma drop is fairly interesting. The Enigma works really well on a Naga Siren squad for a lot of reasons. The primary reason, because Enigma is going to give you teamfight in the same way that the Tidehunter gave teamfight to DK in the last game, which is going to allow you to more effectively do 4-on-5 while that Naga Siren farms. That's the key. You need to have AoE spells on that team with the Naga Siren so that your team can open up space for you even if they're playing a man down. And the Enigma is a great hero for that. In addition, you're obviously able to do great work with the Black Hole if you have an entire Siren Song to figure out what the best place to place it is. So a lot of reasons why that Enigma makes a lot of sense, even though he's not the most in-meta hero in the game right now.
Absolutely. And I like what DK did here. They picked up Murana Lion, which are both that Murana is generally run as support by DK in the hands of, I believe it'll be MMY. Lion's going to be a support, obviously. And so C-Deck has to go into the ban phase literally not having any idea what DK is planning for them. And DK now has a massive advantage as they go into the second phase of this draft.
I am really, really shocked that there has not been a Shadow Demon ban here coming out of LGD. Like, yeah, that could be a support Murana. That makes sense given the current meta in the Chinese scene. But it's just such a potent early and mid-game combo. And the Shadow Demon, unlike most supports, goes late fairly well. He ends up dying a lot if you bring him late. Just at every level of play because he's so squishy and it's hard to get his health up and it's hard to get his mobility up. But the Soul Catcher, a base 50% pure damage boost to any incoming damage, that works as a separate instance as well so that it cannot be quelled in any real way, is extraordinary through all stages of the game because it's percent based. Take away half of a hero's health. It's like having an AA around. But instead of knocking it down to like 11%, try knocking it down 50%. It's right. Insane. So even if you are going to normally want to run that Murana as a support, if you have the opportunity to run her as a carry, which is by no means a bad call, with that Shadow Demon, that is very scary.
Absolutely. Now, I think that the reason that the Shadow Demon didn't come out is they know how much they love that Murana support. More importantly, they proved last time around Murana can land those arrows with or without any kind of setup. She was lights out on using those arrows last round. It was pretty rare that we saw a miss. Even when there was a dodge, it basically hit someone else. So she's good at throwing them down really nice lines. And I think LGC C-Deck knows that, hey, we honestly have to get these bans in that we're really worried about countering us. More than we're worried about that early gank with the Shadow Shaman combo.
So the Rubick... Go ahead.
I was going to say, because Lion with his Hex and his stuns pretty much give her the same setup in a lot of different ways. Yep. But go ahead.
I just wanted to point out that the Rubick is an interesting call here because there's a lot of really great spells to steal, but for the most part, you're not going to get your hands on them because they're very difficult to grab. Like the Clockwork Hookshot, that's a good spell to steal, but it's only a good spell to steal if your team's already in position anyway, and not really the best. The Cogs, once again, decent spell to steal. Moonlight Shadow is great to steal, but the chances of you getting that, because she's going to be invisible and not near you when she casts it for the most part. So very difficult to grab that as well. Arrow is a fantastic spell. Of course, Finger, also great. But there's just, in terms of spells that are really easy to just grab and use, it's not exactly a smorgasbord form. And in addition, there is a fair amount of magical damage now out of the Shadow Fiend, which wasn't there before, and out of the Lion. But the Null Field, this is not a team that has the most magic damage for that Null Field to block. So it's not going to give them as much of a late game edge as Rubicks normally do.
Absolutely. So FaZe just let me know that Clockwork for the 13-14 season, so the 2013-14, Clockwork is Ice's top pick. He's the number one most played hero by Ice. Well, would not be surprised to see Mushi working the mid lane with that Shadow Fiend, as Ice's Clockwork is strong, to say the least.
Yeah, if you've never seen Ice play that Clockwork, you're in for a treat. Like, not just you, but like people in the world, people watching this. If you've not seen it, if he does end up taking that, which I suspect he will, that is a very, very fun hero to watch him on. He just has really great map awareness and aim on that hook. Timing, everything is just to the pinnacle of play. So, Invoker going to come out here for LGD. Presumably, that is going to be a farming safe lane Invoker with the Naga Siren and potentially an aggressive tri lane coming out of LGD, but they have options. The off lane Invoker is something we see in North America a little bit now. We might end up seeing them decide to do that route, though it's less likely here in the Chinese scene, I believe. The Naga Siren could take the farming position, and we could have the Invoker in the mid. So they have options, but for the most part, I would expect Invoker safe lane, probably aggressive tri lane with rotations, Naga Siren mid.
Sorry, got caught by Jan. But yeah, I think that's probably the best bet. But it, I mean, like he says, it gives them flexibility. They can run Naga in the middle like we saw last game if they want to. They've got a lot of options. Lifestealer banned out by LGD.
All right.
Morphling is grabbed. Oh, man.
Well, it wasn't a Chinese game until Morphling got picked, right? Morphling against a Naga. Talk about the Battle of the Farmers.
Yeah, it should be pretty interesting. I mean, honestly, DK, the way that they have been playing, is going to get this Morphling shotgun up and running very fast. And then we're just going to start to see the hunt for Naga Siren. And I think that if they can get her anywhere prior to that 16-minute mark, what CDEX can run into the same problem they ran into in the last game.
Yeah, I don't think that this is a rare case, but I don't think LGD CDEX, as it is right now, pending their fifth pick, actually have the late game locked up in any way. I think DK has a stronger late game team up against a farming Naga Siren. That's saying something. But Shadow Fiend does very well. Morphling, obviously one of the hardest farmers in the game, and he's one of the few that actually has the global presence to sort of handle Naga Siren. You can still be ratted out if you have that Morphling, but it's much more difficult to do the rat. And Mirana, her win rate with dual or tri-cores is just extraordinary. So.
Yeah, I mean, that's really the best part of bringing a Mirana support to the game, and she's one of those supports that doesn't lose scaling as you move into the late game. So the late game on DK, once again, is insanely strong, and CDEX finds themselves with a lineup that's going to need to get into the lead early on, but has a Naga Siren farm on their team now. So that deny pick may come back to bite them in the backside.
Yeah. They are, I mean, they're in a position to get in the lead early on just because they have a really, really great tri support or tri semi support that is very strong through the early and mid game at rotating, very strong at early game aggression. Like the Rubik's Telekinesis is an amazing spell for punishing misplacement. If DK, if anybody on DK is anywhere near out of place, that Rubik is going to pick him out. And the Ancient Apparition obviously boosting everybody's attack damage so that these semi supports and supports are actually able to output enough damage to get kills early. So I don't want to say I hate LGD's lineup. They absolutely drafted terribly. They got outdrafted. It's just, and it's not working again. So I'm not sure what's going on. I'll have to try and fix it. But for the most part, I do think that LGD is on the clock.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, they're on the clock in a lot of ways, almost more so than they were in the last game. So in the last game, they picked up a lot of pushers. They need to get an early game. They need to take some towers. This time around, it's really going to be on the shoulders of this Naga Siren. How fast can she get her push up and running? And immediately, they're going to smoke up and head into the jungle.
Yeah, they are going to do this aggressive warding position. This is presumably because they are going to, I still think they're probably planning on running an aggressive try. They're going to run right into their opponents here. They're going a very awkward route, actually. Gardner is going to find himself a telekinesis, and there is not the leap on MMY. Yeah, there's going to be stun of early first blood. So that awkward route pays off. MMY just kind of walks in and feeds the lion.
Yeah, last time they tried to do the same thing. It didn't work out. This time they changed it up. They went with a route that, like you said, is awkward, but more importantly, unexpected and unusual. And they got a really nice kill out of that. Mirana landing in the middle of that pack behind enemy lines, knowing there wasn't a whole lot that she could do to get out of it. And that was a really good, necessary start for CDEX, especially considering that last hit goes to the Naga Siren.
Yeah, she scaled that leap while she was dying. She just didn't have the time to scale it and also get out. So if her fingers were just a little bit faster, she may not have died there. But the reason this is an awkward route, just so everybody who's watching is aware, why you don't normally see that positioning, is because you have to go up double high ground. You got to move up. In order to get into your opponent's jungle, you have to move up into high ground twice. And the only indicator that you have that your opponent is there is your smoke will go away so that they can see you. So it's just typically something that you stay away from, which is why MMY felt perfectly safe just walking down that pathway.
He did. But that ward was all kinds of value, because they threw that ward up the second they got into range. That allowed them to see her as soon as the smoke dissipated. And like we saw, Rubik's telekinesis made it effective. So beautiful play there. I guess we're on through some introductions very, very quickly.
All right. Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so for the Dire Sign on DK, we've got Mushi playing the Shadow Fiend. We've got Lanham on the Lion. Ice, Ice, Ice will be bringing in the Clockwork. Burning on the Morphling, and MMI, no big surprise there, rocking the Mirana.
All right, and of course, for LGD, we are going to have Garter already playing that Rubik, as we saw. Maybe he's going to be sliding around on that Naga Siren. HHH is going to be chilling out on the Ancient Apparition in the mid lane. We've got the Invoker played by, oh, geez, I should have remembered this name, but I don't remember this name.
It is played by XH.
Yes, XH. There we go. And, of course, 333 on the Nyx Assassin. It's the middle of the night, you guys. Give me a break. I know the player, but it is I did not get a cat nap, unlike Toffees, who got a couple of hours of sleep, so I'm going to blame it on that. No cat naps for Gorgon. He stays up. He man-modes this stuff.
Man modes. All right, that's fair. Oh, look at this arrow.
Ooh, up top.
Creep takes the hit.
Not going to see any additional action there. But and this is actually great. Look at this aggression coming out of LGD. As soon as they see that arrow goes out, they know they have almost 20 seconds of aggression behind them, and they immediately move in on that Morphling. The second that arrow goes out, it's such a dangerous skill to let loose because you have to spam it. You have to assert lane aggression because you miss 100% of the arrows that you don't shoot. But at the same time, every time you shoot it, you are basically telling your opponents, rush us right now. So every time you shoot it, every single time, your carry is going to be pushed out of farming, pushed out of the farm and potentially be moved on for a kill. A very dangerous spell to have and not have. There's really no good balance. Unless you're hitting every one of your arrows, which very few players do.
MNY did just pick up a double damage rune. Is standing inside of range there, but there's a massive arrow.
And that will miss, and that is the indicator. However, the cold snap goes out, and oh boy. This is... Invoker did not... Well, he saw the arrow go out, so he knows he can't be stunned in, but the double damage is still going to hurt him a little bit. I thought that he might take a little bit more damage than that, but it did not look like Mushi was interested in this kill whatsoever. He's not interested in harassing because he knows he probably won't be able to get the kill, so he just wants to use this space to get as much in terms of last hit as possible. Get those souls up and get that damage going.
And that's it, getting those souls rolling. It was a smart play. They bought a little bit of space for him where, you know, he needs to get those up and running. He's going to struggle a little bit against... XY, I think it's XY. Sorry, no, not XY. I keep forgetting the letters too. It is XH.
Yeah.
He's gonna struggle a little bit of XH in the first couple of levels, but like we said, you buy him a little bit of space, and he not only is Shadow Fiend strong in this position, but it's even stronger because it's in the hands of Mushi.
Yeah, so this is also not the best position for DK to find themselves in the world, because we were saying that Naga Siren needs to get going fast, like as fast as the DK's Naga Siren got going just about. Maybe is on top of the net worth by over 600 at this point. So not doing too shabby. That first blood really helping out. And of course, the farm is very strong. She is on top of the net worth with this aggressive tri lane. Not usually the position you want to put a Naga Siren in if you have to prioritize her farm, but it is working out very well. And this solo 3-3-3 on the Nyx Assassin is going to get Vendetta up really soon.
Yeah, it's working surprisingly well.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a ton of aggression potential coming out here. Mm-hmm. And the Naga Siren did get a level of net rather than going straight for her illusions like you might often see the farming Naga Siren do.
Oh. I don't know if you said that. So there was a smoke gank prepped out by C-Deck as they were rotating towards the bottom to try to put a little bit of punishment here on Mushi. And it just so happened that MMI was doing a rune check and was leaving range and pulled the smoke on the Ancient Apparition. So it's just a really fortunate placement that allowed Mushi to know exactly what was coming.
All right. And yeah, not... Ooh, up top, actually. We're going to see MMI is getting ready for the arrow. And there is an alone maybe. They know this because they can see. Okay, the leap down to the low ground to set up the arrow, but the arrow is not going to be thrown. It hit the sling, but it did not get loosed. Mm-hmm. He did not really have the angle for it. Ice playing very cautiously here. He knows something is up. He knows that there are no supports up in the top lane. Mm-hmm. And they are going to try to move in, but he's just going to be defensive. Hang out up here and use his rocket, try and get last hits from afar.
Yep. No, it was a smart play. It was a good sixth sense buy maybe to make sure that the... he knew that something was up. He knew Murana was missing and played that very, very well.
All right. Ice taking a long road all the way around, scouting out to see if he can find somebody. He's looking for somebody in the jungle because he knows everybody's missing. And meanwhile, we are going to have a rotation here coming out of DK from the jungle high ground. They are waiting. From the high ground, they wait. And they're going to stalk down here through the low ground in the river. And here they come, smoked up. The hookshot is there from behind on Ice. And, the stun is going to miss. And the Ghostwalk is there. And a little bit of a frenzy there coming out of Mushi, just throwing up to the high ground for some reason on those Shadow Races. Not quite angled correctly. And it's going to be an absolutely free rotation coming out for LGD. DK paid a lot there. They paid a smoke. They had every single one of their non-cores rotate.
Mm-hmm.
And they still didn't manage to grab anything other than a couple free creeps for Mushi.
Invoker had that Ghostwalk up in seconds and was out of there and beautifully done.
Oh boy, HHH. Taking a fair amount of damage here. He grabs that double damage rune, though, and now Shadow Fiend has no bottle. And Morphling, meanwhile, going to get a solo kill up on the Naga Siren. So Burning, earning his place here.
Yeah,
that's not what you normally see coming out of a solo Morphling early game kills. I mean, Waveform's a really great nuke, but doesn't really have any way to lock you down.
Yeah, and it was a huge necessity. I mean, when we talked about the net worth a little while ago, Naga Siren was doing really, really well. She was up by about 600 or 700, 800, I think it was. Yeah. Now she's only up by about 100. So that was a great kill by Burning, much needed, and he's start getting caught up in that farm. And like we said, that Morphling, if he comes online before the Naga Siren, is going to be very tough for C-Deck to build to deal with.
Yeah, taking a look here through positioning, it does look like Ice wants to come in behind here on XH again. There is going to be a pause, and I'm going to take this moment to take a look at the inventories. We don't see a whole lot of anything coming out here, but there is most notably still no vision for the Invoker, no True Sight coming out on behalf of DK. So, DK, if they do go for this move on the Invoker, it is Quas Wex. They will not have any way to lock him down. If they get him in cogs, maybe the Shadow Raises will be enough to kill him off. But that's a big, big if. We're going to see MMY move in, get ready for the arrow as well from the top. So basically what they're hoping is long stun flying down here on the arrow, followed by the hook shot and the cogs, holding him in place and stunned so long that he's unable to actually get that ghost walk off. It's a tall order, especially considering how many creeps are blocking from that north side.
Right. It is. That said, though, I mean, at this point, Mushi's really looking to get pure farm, doesn't want to blow any money on reveal. And if even if they don't get the kill on Invoker here and they force him back to base, because I believe he is, he's out of regen right now, it's a victory for them. It gives Mushi more time on the mid. It makes the clockwork rotation worthwhile. And I think they're going for that as much. I mean, they'd love the kill, but if it forces them off lane, hey, all the better.
You know what? Yeah, they'll take it. And if they can just buy Mushi space, you're right. That gives them a fair amount. I don't know that it gives them enough to warrant having all of their heroes constantly rotating, because they're going to start feeling it inexperience if they don't continue to grab kills. And actually, they are feeling it inexperience. Yep. If you look at the experience chart, I mean, 300 is not that big of a swing, but 300 in 3 minutes, 100 a minute, about on average, one level two to level three or something like that over the course of 3 minutes. It's really pretty negligible, but it's a steep climb that is a trend to watch for, because they've been rotating so much. They have not been in lane. They have not been in jungle, and no farm makes for a sad, sad mid game.
That said, though, DK is getting the levels on the heroes that matter. So when you look at the stack chart, it is six across the boards for all of the three heroes that we're looking at moving us into the mid game. Granted, Mirana and Lion a bit lower than they'd like them to be.
No. But the AA and the Rubick are just as low. So it's
they're matched up. They're keeping it even with C-Deck. And honestly, C-Deck's not making nearly as many rotations. So the fact that there are more levels in this essence on DK is really encouraging, I think, because they've been able to keep the aggression up. They've been able to keep C-Deck thinking about where's the next get coming from. And they're essentially stealing XP from C-Deck by just making them have to play a little more passive because of those rotations.
Yeah, three times the experience differential between these teams is the differential between their relative offlaners or their relative solo laners, the Nyx Assassin and the Clockwork. Nyx Assassin has about 900 experience over the Clockwork, including a full level, almost two levels. And so that is where literally all of their experience lead is. It's all plus some. The rest of their heroes are actually a little bit behind, all things said and done. The Nyx Assassin has not really been active so far yet, though. LGD, they do have the Nyx. He is farming up. He's getting going. It's only 7 minutes in. Once that Nyx Assassin, with his fairly heavy experience lead, and I would assume fairly heavy gold lead as well, over this. Yeah, look at the gold lead on the Clockwork to the Nyx Assassin. It's 500. So, it's just growing. So with that fairly decent lead, around the 10-12 minute mark, when he starts getting active, we could see DK bugging out a little bit as they struggle to maintain a fair amount of map controls. Right now, they're rotating a lot. They have that map control. They're used to that map control. But when all things are said and done, they are losing out on the ability to maintain it.
I agree with that. So, and like we said, it's going to be a very interesting next, I would say, 6 to 7 minutes. I think the next 6 to 7 minutes are going to show us a good dictation of where the pace of the mid game is going to end up. So if C-Deck gets that Nyx Assassin out, if he gets a good pickoff or two, if he already has that level advantage, he's starting to really come online. If they get a good pick or two, then I think C-Deck has the position to buy the time they need for Naga Siren to come online. That said, if they can't get a couple of picks here, that Morphling is looking like he could become a major issue if they can't put the kibosh on him.
Yeah, so I completely drifted out for part of what you said because I jumped over to the Twitch chat. And I normally don't like to bring up the Twitch chat in the cast, but the first thing I saw is something along the lines of sometimes a dude just needs some kale.
Yeah, no, they're discussing the importance of DK pausing out because Lion had to go get himself some vegetables.
Well, you know what? It makes for a strong boy. And if I learned anything from Popeye, it's that when you're having a little bit of trouble, grab those veggies. It's going to make it happen. Can of spinach and you're all
right. Right. So it looks like Phage is having some connection issues as well.
It's a service, probably. For us, because we're in the West, we have to get through a whole snaking turbine of, just absolutely computer science hack for us to actually stay connected. And we do get a little bit of lag because of it. Sometimes we can't connect at all. And Phage is, of course, one of us damn Yanks. So I assume that that is the issue for him. Mm-hmm. But obviously all these players are Chinese, so I'm not entirely sure what the issue is with Lion. There doesn't seem to be, Kale, I don't know what that means. That is where the kale joke came from. I get it now, guys. I caught up. I'm a slow runner, but I go distances. That's the thing. Go distances. I'm not a sprinter, guys. You got to give me time to catch up.
You got there eventually, though.
All right, there we go. And I see what was happening. Lion was just waiting for me to get what the heck was going on. Put all the pieces together. I Sherlock Holmes my way into this one. I'll tell you what.
You did.
But that one piece puzzle, I made it happen. One piece. I think I'm ready for the 10-piecer that my nephew does.
Right? A little picture of a dinosaur. That said, though, it looks like the game is back underway. It's 1-1 right now.
Here we go. This is that initiation that we talked so long about and not quite there.
No, and that's it again. Yeah. He just gets himself out of that one.
It was exactly what we said. There were too many creeps on the north side for that to be an arrow initiation. So the Mirana came in, gave away the ghost, and the hookshot is just not long enough of a stun to set up a long arrow. Up in the top lane, we're going to have Burning do a little bit of harassment up on the maybe, but it's not going to end up being enough, and the rotations are here as well.
Yeah, I thought we were going to see them try to go in behind the tower with that rotation.
But they decided just to go ahead and farm out these creeps that were pulled. The arrow's going to just kind of whiffed helplessly by as an assassin grabbing himself a kill here in the mid lane. So that's what I was talking about with that Nyx assassin getting active. All things said and done up in the top lane. We're going to see Garter take a fair amount.
Miscommunication.
Ooh. It's communication express, yeah.
Yeah, the arrow missed, and the opening stun by Lana basically meant we've blown everything we've got. Rubick took that as, hey, this is a great chance. We wanted the pickoff. Let's make this happen. Yeah. He ran away, but maybe in HHH were on their way out when he pulled his telekinesis. So essentially, all he did with the telekinesis is put his enemy closer to him.
Yeah. Come over here and give me some love, bud.
Please gank me.
Yeah, please. I am feeding you a gank. I am an all-you-can-eat gank buffet.
So that said, a little bit of miscommunication coming out of C-Deck. But like we said, I was saying a little minute ago, C-Deck is, I think most people would agree, the overwhelming underdogs in this match. DK expected to win it. And C-Deck doing pretty well for themselves, not letting DK run away with this just yet.
Isis standing in kind of a weird location, watching out for that rune, I assume. And hoping to find somebody come for it with that hook shot. So he wants to actually grab, I assume, mid. But it's just not happening as of right now because, I mean, Invoker's not a bottle-running hero. So he doesn't care about that rune nearly as much. So meanwhile, Ice still waiting for someone to come on that rune. And there's a three-man rotation coming down here. Instead, right when that three-man rotation comes, Mushi comes down for this rune while Ice guards him. Now Ice thinking about maybe he's spinning around in circles. I see him down there on the minimap. He's thinking about moving in here onto the Naga Siren. And he is actually going to come up straight behind that long wait, actually paying off here. Great hook. The cogs are there. Maybe does have Siren Song, but can't get it off. The cast animation is too long. And that is, he's trying so hard. The mini stun is just too strong. And that stun from 333, not enough to save the Slithery Woman. She will be headed on back to the Fountain.
Yeah, that Nyx Impale was just a second too late, but really nice play. Also, the key to that kill was MMI's combination leap arrow that was just beautifully executed.
Yeah, the battery assault is just a great skill to have up against any hero with any sort of cast time, especially for their escape, where Naga Siren is top of the list of heroes who find that battery assault unendingly frustrating. So 333 going to butt heads a little bit with MY, and they're just going to kind of pass each other and say goodbye. Shadow Fiend grabbing a regen rune for his bottle. And probably going to rotate back around toward the lane. Taking a look at our jungles here. No stacks coming out for... One stack, I lied. Coming out here for DK. And no stacking, it looks like, whatsoever. Oh, one stack also for LGD. So
look, big gold swing coming if you look at the graph right now. It's not massive in the sense of
big
overall numbers.
Relatively, yeah.
Relative. The problem is that where we saw Nagasarin doing very well on the farm early on, Morphling has gained over 1,000 gold on her in terms of net worth. And that is not good because that Morphling is really getting himself going pretty quickly here by comparison. And like we said, that is the key to victory. The key to victory for LGD was to not allow that to happen.
Look at Ice. Once again, he's just so patient. It's like watching a deer hunter. He's going to give himself a little bit of vision with that rocket, but maybe he should know exactly where he is. The trajectory of that rocket couldn't have come from anywhere, but right on top of this little island of woods. So let's see if he wants to stay here because he knows exactly what he's risking being around. He's got two supports nearby, though.
Yeah, he does. He's sitting in a deer stand, basically, waiting for a chance to make this on this. And once he sees that there's two, I don't think he saw the rotation.
He does not know these supports are here. And this is the only reason Nagasarin feels so safe being near Ice. We saw what happened last time. Ice got that hook and battery saw. Oh, up top, we are going to see an engagement here in the jungles. Mushi takes a fair amount of damage, but 3-3-3 in a little bit too deep. He is going to be hexed and he will be going down.
That Earth Spike was massive. It was perfectly shot out. The range was incredible. And just tail-ended him. After the arrow misses, Lion says, we don't need no stinking arrow.
And they just move in anyway, yeah. This, taking a look here at the net worth, the DK is starting to, or Team DK, I guess there is no the DK in this game, but Team DK doing very, very well. Ice is going to try to avoid a cold feet here. He will be able to thanks to that. No, actually not. The hookshot not going to bring him out far enough. He's got the cogs. Oh, great placement. And he forces all three heroes off his rear end. There's going to be a TP reaction. They're going to invest four heroes on trying to kill him. And he's going very, very deep in. He gets around that island. And the stun is there. Oh,
what?
But it goes right through him. Oh,
sneaky
3-3-3.
Clockwork.
Not quite fast enough on the draw there. Wow. Would not have made it in the Old West in this particular case.
No, that was not. Wyatt Earp, he is not. That said, though, ninja-style play from Clockwork to find the only position he could to try and get himself out of that situation and just barely slips away from what looked really bad.
Remember what I was saying about Ice and his Clockwork? Like, it's really good positioning all the time. And here's the other nice thing about this Clockwork. Unlike a lot of Clockwork players in the world, he plays from behind really well, which means he can be much more patient than other Clockwork players can. He can wait forever to try and grab a kill because he plays so well at a gold and experience disadvantage. He understands the hero's limitations just so strong. And another stack going out here by Garter for that Nagasarin who is going to split, but there is a Clockwork hiding. And now they see him. They know he is just going to run away. Yeah. Mirana already kind of running away.
Right,
and everybody out of GD coming down to support this potential fight that is coming out because the Clockwork not giving up the ghost on this quite yet. Yeah, this is a very costly moment for LGD though. They're not going to get anything out of this except maybe a team fight that they aren't really prepared for. So there's a TP reaction coming out of an invisible Mushi. He's coming down here. He's going to get ready for his ultimate in there with max souls. And he's trying. There's the cogs, and they do manage to grab 3-3-3. That's going to be the initiation for the fight, and there's going to be that Max Souls ulti. And Requiem for a team is more like it. That is going to be very, very decimated squad. And the Invoker is going to be next to drop, it looks like. He doesn't have the Ghost Walk up, and he's not trying to get it up. Siren Song is here if they need it, so maybe feeling pretty confident being pretty far forward. But the Invoker is going to be wrapped around behind. They know Moonlight Shadow is up. And he is still being very bold because he does have that invis. Now Mushi is going to be netted down. He is going to try and just walk himself away. Invoker is still here. And now Garter is going to be taken down further low. That's going to be the Siren Song. Maybe he's going to wait. Try to get their team out. Maybe not. They're still going to fight this. Getting more of her team in. The Invoker throws out the Tornado. The MP is going out as well. And now Mushi getting very low. He might want to need backup. Oh, great block by Lanham.
Nice body block.
And there's the net. Maybe is going to get that kill. But the arrow is going to be dodged. There's no mana on maybe. But she doesn't really need it to back up. And very nice stun going on in MMY coming out of 333. Some more auto attacks incoming there as Burning comes in to defend. But 333 goes up into Vendetta. Now the question is he going to try to get it? He will, but there is the leap to get him into safety. Now Ice 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 on chopping block. He cannot get out. He's trapped in here with 333, but is 333 also trapped in?
There's
going to be
arrow.
An additional arrow. That's going to be enough to stun the mana drain going out of the EMP. It's going to take Ice 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 all the way down. Will end up going down to Maybe, who's just getting her farm out of last hits on heroes here. So not as costly as one might think.
I'm not really sure who won that thing.
Yeah, that was a lot of back and forth. Maybe Phage Guy can help us out if he was paying attention. Yeah. I would guess, all things said and done, DK came out ahead. There wasn't quite as much travel required for DK, and they did not really... It felt like they were getting a little bit more onto their heroes with some of their AoE stuff. Invoker's going to grab another kill, though, so that might turn that around. Yeah, DK did take a little bit there. But off that fight, actually, golden experience goes the way of LGD, so... LGD...
Yep. So LGD comes out just a little bit ahead. I think it was some TPs were required out of DK to get themselves back into the fight. Yeah. That said, though, LGD spent a long time. I don't remember that big jungle rotation that they did to get down there for that fight. Yeah. Whoa. That was a lot bigger of a line than I expected it to be.
Woo!
Yeah, I don't know how that happened. Anyway,
that's how far they had to travel. It's a long line because it was a long walk, man. It was like watching Lord of the Rings.
It was Homer's Odyssey getting down there. So the point
let's
is
not bring up the Greeks again. This never works out for us.
It never works out for us. Mesoamerican. Anyway, so they they spent a lot of time. They wasted a lot of time getting down there. And so they did win the fight. That said, in terms of overall XP or gain in terms of farm, maybe about even because of the extra time that DK got while they set up for that fight.
Yeah, the experience went pretty heavily the way of LGD if you look at the chart, but the farm didn't end up going one way or the other, which works out perfectly fine for DK. They're happy to run even, or they're happy to hold a 5,000 gold lead because the Naga Siren, if she's 5,000, if her team is 5,000 behind, that means that she's going to be coming out on time, if not late. And that's really all DK needs. That Naga Siren needs to come out on time or late. And right now she's at 17 minutes, still no Radiance to speak of. We do have the BKB did just during that little chit-chat we were having come out by Shadow Fiend. The Invoker does have the Orchid up, and a Morphling is sitting on top of his Midas as well as Perseverance. So.
MMY on the bottom.
Oh, he will not be able to get away. And now Ice 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 also on chopping block. He is getting very low, and he has an A-ult on him, so he
nice
will be
blocks.
Going down as well. That very nice shatter. Mushi could be in trouble here as well. 333 coming in. Oh, he breaks Vendetta to go for the stun and isn't able to. He actually broke Vendetta to use his magic wand to get enough mana to throw the stun, and he missed the stun. That's like the lady who ate the cat to swallow the mouse that, whatever, I don't remember how the children's tale goes.
Swallow the spider to eat the fly, swallow the cat to catch the spider, swallow the dog to keep the cat.
Do you swallow a cat to eat a spider? Like, is that a thing cats are known
for?
No, okay, down in the bottom, we're going to have a fight, so maybe we should... Get rid of the nursery rhymes and focus. What do you think this is?
Come on. It swallowed a bird to eat a spider, by the way, and the cat was to get
there you go. See, I mean, it doesn't make sense anyway, but it makes a little more sense there. Wheels is going to... Wow, Mushi gets hit by the tail. The tail of it passes over him.
Yeah.
Talk about pathing. And he will not be going down low enough, but... Yeah.
So right now, DK up by about 5k gold in terms of farm. XP, not a huge differential. It's only 2,500. But the real problem is the net worth stack chart. If you look at it, that Morphling is sitting at 8,000 right now.
Yeah, this is... I don't want to say DK is running away with it because they're really not. But they are certainly in a very favored position because their late game is strong. They have one of the few heroes who can actually go toe-to-toe with that Naga Siren in the late in terms of his ability to be globally active. And, of course, they also have some additional cores that I think are stronger cores, especially with the Quas Wex on that Invoker. He doesn't have the damage output. Oh, Hook is going to miss. And that is a very sad Ice. That would have been a almost certain kill.
Yeah, they realized, I think, that there was a good three-man. They set up the Moonlight Shadow. They wanted to go in on that and realized that, hey, yellow and blue are both missing. I don't think this is a good idea, and had great self-control to back themselves off of that fight. And I like that play. Burning Hand of Midas is really going to make him a force to be reckoned with if he's allowed to keep what he's doing going into the 25-minute mark.
I mean, I've been saying I mean a lot today because I'm tired, so I'm latching onto phrases. It is meant by me that this is a case where the Midas actually works out. I'm a heavy critic of Midas purchase in professional play. It's pro games, especially in NA and EU. They end so quickly that the Midas often, in my opinion, doesn't end up paying off. I think that you're better off just going for some survive, building some damage, and just trying to get as many last hits as you can, getting active. This is a case where the Midas is really going to pay off. You cannot expect either of these teams to end before 40 minutes, right?
No, it's a Morphling versus a Naga Siren. Like, I mean, right. this is a great place for a Midas on that Morphling. And Morphling, arguably one of the heroes that benefits well from the Midas.
Ooh,
and a lot of other
later
ones.
MMO.
Wow.
Locked see, in the popsicle bunk. Section. Yeah, that is. That is not. That is not a happy, happy camper.
He crossed the train tracks and was not prepared to be on that side of town.
Yeah, man. Don't let that West Side Story stuff, you know, make you think. All the snapping and singing. They're still tough guys, and they will wreck you. I don't know why I jumped to West Side Story. My mind's in a weird place tonight, dude. Everybody watching this is like, this caster is schizophrenic. I don't know what he's talking about ever. Children's Tales and Lord of the Rings for no reason. Anyway, Ice coming in here, trying to get in, but there's going to be a smoke rotation coming out here.
And that's a good tower get for him. It puts him even on the tier ones. That said, there is some good push going up here on the top, but this said, they're going to force out TPs because they can't yield this tier two. They can't yield this tier two just yet.
All right. Yeah, there is some pressure going on to tier two, and Burning has enough damage to really make this count. There is also, I think there's, nope, maybe not. It looks like a Desolator, but there is no Desolator. That's weird. It's just the way that my graphics are rendering, I guess.
MMI could be in trouble here.
Yeah, he's in trouble a lot this game, and he's going to find himself Vendetta'd right up the bum. Oh, nice leap, but will be enough. And, oh, Ice coming in, trying to save the day. He hooks a creep, and that creep goes down to the grave, but Ice might be joining him. There's a nice two-man stun coming out of Lanham. Will they be able to get it? There's going to be an additional Hex, and the Cogs goes up
double
and grabs
cog.
Two. Ice coming in. Really well played by this. Like, Lanham and Ice, their coordination there. It was like watching a ballet. And that was Swan Lake. Levels of coordination.
That was beautiful. So they trade a tier two for two tier ones. They get a nice pickoff on MMY, but immediately CDEC comes, or I'm sorry, DK comes back around and says, no one hurts my Murana without paying the ultimate price. And they take two, and it was a beautifully executed hook, double cog, and there wasn't anything that those two could do to get away.
Okay, Naga's Radiance is finally coming out. When this is actually, I think 18 minutes is like the average for a pro Murana. Mm-hmm. Have you factor in the fact that she was an aggressive tri-lane Murana, and the fact that that has a significant amount of outliers, that like the way that statistics ended up working out is that you're more likely, really, in terms of looking for that radiance, I would estimate 20 to 22 minutes is really when you expect to see it. 18 minutes is an average, but it's not a super accurate average in terms of the way the numbers actually realistically come out. I don't know how to describe it without going too into statistics and quantiles and stuff. So basically just take my word for it. 20, 22 minutes, despite what you see in the numbers, it's a pretty good time for that Radiance. It's what you'd normally expect. But for how active this game has been out of DK with the rotations, it's not quite early enough for LGD to feel comfortable.
Yeah, Bernie's got the Lincoln Sphere running. He's sitting on his treads. Might have started to pay off in dividends. And, I mean, it's just... you're right. I don't think it's fast enough.
There's the hook. Trouble. And the Hex, and they're trying to get some vision around these trees. This bloody forest keeps getting in the way, and they're just going to chop the whole thing down. Mushi getting that last hit on that kill, bringing him up to 5-2, sending a very strong record so far this game. 3-3-3, trying to farm up a little bit of something. He's trying to get his Blink Dagger up, and he almost has it. However, they're going to trade off a tower for his ability to get some farm, and Burning has the Lincolns up as well. They can look at the rest of our items. Yasha now up on the Shadow Fiend, along with that Mask of Death that we saw. There is Phase Boots up on the Murana, not too much else. She's not building a lot of support items, I assume because she's planning on going into a semi-core if this game goes too long. So she doesn't want to invest too much on those heavy support items. So she's just going to play from a gold deficit. And then try to save up and make sure that she gets into the semi-support role.
She went for some support items early on, allowed that lion to get that Blink Dagger up, and now that he's got it, they'll trade those positions. So you should see her pick up some good items now. Now, the next assassin did just pick up a Blink Dagger as well, which I think a little bit late, but a necessary grab for him. That said, gold lead's still sitting at about 5,500 for DK, and that Morphling has just been getting the last hits on the towers, pushing on his own, getting tons and tons of free farm. And I just don't know what they do to deal with it.
Yeah, well, they've got the Naga Siren, and they have to rely on her. They have to have faith that their Naga Siren is going to be able to get farm fast enough to offset this gold deficit that they're falling into, and really to handle the Morphling before that shotgun is fully prepared to just decimate their supports. AA is one of the easiest supports in the game to kill. He's very, very difficult to play. He's very, very difficult to play up against a team that's going to have a huge late-game nuker like the Morphling. One of the few heroes who actually has that late-game nuke. So AA from this point forward is basically going to be warding. He's going to be trying to be in the back of fights if L, Bynum, and MMY caught out once again. Having a little bit of trouble so far this game.
MMY me is, I think, what's going on over there right now. But that said, I mean, it's a...
I wish that joke carried over into the Chinese, but I'm sure
it doesn't. Right? I don't think it does.
Language barriers, man. Language barriers. They ruin my puns, or your puns.
So here's the thing about the support Mirana is I love the support Mirana because I think it makes you feel better about investing in these ganks on her. But in the end, at the end of the day, if you look at her farm compared to the rest of her team, she's buying wards again. She's pretty much committed to the fact that she's not going to be core at this point. She's been picked off too many times. But every time that C-Deck does get the grab, they're burning a lot of resources to make sure that she goes down.
All right, burning is going to be moved on here. The Lincoln's in the pop. There's the telekinesis. Aeol is going to land, and this is a dead Morphling. Very great execution, and that is how you rehydrate. Getting that water man out of the way.
And Rubick finally, I think, got his hands on. No, he got on the replicate. He wanted that shift.
So I was keeping track of how much gold Mushi is getting from this hex stat, but he bought something while I was watching that fight, so now I don't know. It's got to be well over 1,000, though.
Yep.
Like we're probably looking at about 2,000 gold going the way of DK, because not only was this a hex stack, but he also got a wave as it pushed up here, which was probably, I think, a double wave, and so they stacked while they were knocking it down. It is huge, and he is now sitting on top of a Manta. He's going to solo Roshan here in a moment. Look at this. This is game. Like, I mean, this is just the sort of thing that makes you love watching DK. He's using the illusions to tank Roshan, which you can do only if you place your illusions in place and don't have them do any sort of movement whatsoever. Hold position in such a way that they won't be dispelled by Roshan when he attacks him, because they can't do any sort of movement at him whatsoever, or Roshan won't dispel them. So it's like just the little things. I really just love Protota.
So, and something that Phoenix pointed out over in Twitch chat is that it's mind-boggling that Mushi's not only keeping up, but leading Burning in by over 1,000 net worth, and he has no Midas.
Yeah. I mean, taking a look at what he does have a lot of the last hits. And his team has been largely just trying to beef him up by helping him lift. So, yes, there is the Midas out, and it was a fairly early Midas on Burning.
It was.
But Burning is working out all on his own, whereas Mushi has an entire crew of people coming up with him and just trying to make sure that he stays fit. So he's the guy that goes to the fitness center and hires all of the personal trainers.
All the trainers, all the nutritionists, yeah. Right. He's a
It's not
that
surprising that he can keep up with somebody on steroids. He's working at it, and he's got people helping him.
Plus, he loves that camp.
Yeah. Well,
so rotation looks like DK headed down towards the mid with every resource they have right now.
Yeah.
And C-Deck up on the top, so they could push this mid tower and force out those reactions. I mean, nice little gold get for them.
Naga is getting close to her Manta. This is the time to push for DK. Like, they can take it really, really late, probably. They do have, I think, a superior late game, but not by a whole lot. Like, if they go late, it's anybody's game.
Oh, bang, right there. There's the pick. Clockwork going on Ice, Ice, Ice.
And, her clockwork is Ice, Ice, Ice. The clockwork going after that Nyx Assassin.
Yeah.
Nyx Assassin does end up going down. And the mid lane goes down for Tier 2 as well. And, in addition, the Radiant grabbing themselves a tower the top with the Naga Siren Illusions pushing. And Burning is going to be silenced out here, but it's just going to go ahead and go Scepter up. No harm, no foul. And he's getting very close to that shotgun coming out.
Yep. So, I mean, ultimately, it was a great trade for DK. That said, that Radiant is starting to show just how strong the split push is going to be. But DK doing good, sticking together and making some moves here.
All right. A reprisal gem coming out here on the Mirana. So, very, very quick kill on that Nyx Assassin who just – or on the line. Excuse me. I looked up and just saw the Nyx Assassin. Nyx Assassin just respawning. Rubick going down there as well, making that a 1-for-1. And yeah, there's a gem on both sides now. The Invoker's had a gem and has been counter warding for about 3 minutes now.
Mm-hmm.
The other gem coming out onto MMY, but he's not going to be holding it because he dies so much. It makes no sense for him to have it. So he does. He is holding it. I lied. I thought there was no way they'd be handing it over to him. He's 2-5. Like, they are going to lose that gem if they leave it on him. In fact, they might lose it now. 3-3-3 getting dangerously close to attack range there on that Vendetta. So, taking a look at our overall vision, I just want to switch up so we can take a look. DK just has a Bastion of Vision down here. And other than that, they're basically relying on their lanes. However, Vision for LGD is entirely reliant on the Naga Illusions. That's pretty much all they have. They've got a Defensive Ward in the exact same spot. So, Vision, Reciprocal Vision is prioritized very similarly by these teams. Oh, here we go. And Burning is going to potentially go down here again, and he will. That's a really great pickoff for LGD. And they're getting themselves back into this game pretty handily, I'd say.
Absolutely. No, and they're doing very well for themselves. They're pushing these towers. They're making the game very difficult for DK. And I don't know, man. CDEX really in a strong position. That said, they're still down by a massive gold margin. They're down by a lot of experience, but their push is strong, and it's being showcased on the top right now.
Yeah, so they're not going to be able to push high ground really probably anytime soon, unless they get a huge pickup, and that's really the trouble. They're playing at a 7,500 gold deficit, so they have to be very, very careful about what they decide to move in on and what isn't worth their investiture. And they just need to lose one big team fight, and they're going to be out buybacks, probably out of tier 3, if not out of racks as well. So they cannot afford to be giving up too much. They need to be very, very careful because, like I said, they're doing a really good job of picking strong engagements here. Nice call by Lanham. But all things said and done, I'd say that they're doing a pretty strong job keeping themselves in this, especially considering they are a heavy underdog here.
Absolutely. So FaZe just sent me a message, said that the 7-9K gold at 30 minutes has an 85% win rate, and that's about what we're seeing from DK right now. So the statistics favor DK. That said, CDEC in no way, shape, or form willing to give this one up.
That's Phage, man, coming in with the stats even when he's not able to watch the game. It's just like he knows. He's not even looking them up. He just happens to know all the stats, and he happens to know exactly how the game's going to go. He's predicting it an hour in advance. Like, he could tell us now stats for the 40-minute mark, but he's not going to win the game like that. You know? He's just that good.
So, yeah, and like we said, Phage, our stat guy they brought with us, having a little bit of trouble behind that great firewall and having to do stats from a remote, basically, as he watches the game and tries to feed us things through Skype.
All right, Lanham is going to be possibly dropping down here. He's got that force staff along with the blink dagger, so he's heavily mobile, but not quite mobile enough, and he goes down. The pickoffs are really working out for LGD CDEC. Mushi trying to push in the top, but these illusions are just so much to handle right now. He is doing a pretty strong job of it. Maybe by herself up here, not able to make it happen. And it looks like, Ice coming in from the long range. And there we go. That is going to be an instant kill. The TP reactions are there right away, but it's already done. The Naga Siren's gone down. Mushi is potentially going to go down here as well, but he's got the Aegis, so he's just going to get his health back. And they're not, the hook narrowly missing there for that extra kill, but yeah, I don't know that TPing everybody in for that was really, like, by the time they even tried to TP, the Naga was down, and that was the prize, right? This tier 2 tower, not that important.
They forced out the Aegis, though, which I think is a good thing for them to do. That hookshot, though, that was a massive, beautiful hookshot. I gotta be honest.
Ice, patient player, and he makes those hooks. He is a master hooker.
He is one of the best hookers on the map right now.
He works that corner like nobody's business. That's all I'm going to say. Did he learn it from your mom, Toffees? Or?
Oh, I don't know why we're getting to the flame here. Let's not start that.
All right, let's not get too into it. It is the middle of the night. Come on. You got to keep me up somehow.
All right. So, Gold Feed has cracked 10K for DK with that tower push they just got. XP still 8,000 on their side. And we haven't done an item check-in in a while. So, that's, Ag's up on the clockwork. That's the shot. Full-blown shotgun coming out of Burning has been pretty strong so far. And it looks like we might see an engagement.
Nah, they're not going to be able to get in here soon enough to move in on that evoker. So, yeah, take a look at the items. Double force staff up on LGD. Single force staff. Actually, the hookshot does land on somebody. And, 333 using that force staff, trying to get out, but it's not enough. And the arrow just going to mark the victory.
Yeah, insurance arrow, and that's the second or third time we've seen it. It's on target. It guarantees that if the initiation doesn't work, the follow-up is there. So I really like that insurance arrow play by the Marana.
Well, it works out really well with the clockwork, too, because, I mean, that arrow wasn't really on the mark, all things said and done, because the four staff is up on the Nyx. So the Nyx, you know, Nyx's not going to be in the cogs. But for any other hero, those cogs would have held him in there, and that arrow would have been a huge nuke and also that huge, huge stun. So it was at the right spot. It just wasn't at the right spot for the Nyx assassin. It's impossible for them to predict exactly where he's going to be. Butterfly on Shadow Fiend is not the most favorite thing for LGD to be dealing with. Now the Naga Siren, in addition to getting up a Manta, has to get up, presumably, a Monkey King bar, which is all the more difficult for her to deal with.
Sorry. I was checking out Twitch chat real quick. But yeah, that MKB is going to be strong, and DK's net worth just keeps gaining and gaining and gaining. So last time I checked in was about a minute ago, and it was 10,000. It's about to crack 12 at this point. And Burning, sitting on the Blade, the Lincoln Sphere, and 3,500 gold. I don't know. I C-Deck was doing really well with that Naga Siren for a hot minute there, but I think that at this point, DK's just managed to get the last couple items up that they need, and I don't know that LGD, with the exception of a major mistake by DK, but hey, with DK, how often do we see major mistakes?
Now, you actually, we're waiting for several major mistakes, right? Because they're over 12,000 gold in the lead. Experience is over 10,000 gold in the lead, and you can see exactly the little period of time that we were talking about on that gold chart. It's right where it evens out at the 8,000 mark. We're like, oh, they're doing pretty well. It's evened out for a couple of minutes. They're getting a lot of picks. But even though they were getting picks, they were not out farming, even with the Naga Siren. They're going to get another pick here on Mushi, though. That's a very nice kill. That helps. That certainly does not impede their progress in any way. But the Roshan is up. They're not going to be able to move in on that. They might be able to grab a Tier 2 tower, but even that is kind of a long shot because they're being pushed down here on the top. So they're Tier 3, and they're going to have to TP back to defend this from Burning, who does have the full shotgun up and ready, and is just going to replicate out. Now, free Roshan for DK anytime they want it, because they have complete control up here, and there is no TP potential. They had to TP back here, and even if they didn't have to TP back, there's nowhere to TP to for that Roshan, so I expect a very quick rotation down to the Rockman. Just have a little powwow, hang out. Do some exploration on Roshan's opinion of, you know, being shot with arrows.
Right. That said, it doesn't look like another big hook shot across the river.
And Ice is going to help clean up that kill along with a very nice finger by Lanham. And AA, like I said, really easy hero to kill. He can't be anywhere out past, like, this line at this stage. For him to get any farm, realistically, he needs to be going for a Midas. But he had to go for the mobility to deal with the clock. Went up for that four staff to deal with that clockwork and also to deal with potentially the morphling. Ice is actually going to move in here. The BKB is going to be popped by Invoker. He's trying to get away, and he will do so.
Yep. I'll tell you what, though. Ice hookshots across have made this entire side of the river unsafe as he's been landing them incredibly well.
It is a little robotic. How do you do? Coming in from everywhere. He's not even being patient with it anymore because he's got ags now. So if he sees anyone or even thinks maybe someone's there, he's just going to let loose. And LGD just has to be able to deal with that, which is why they prioritize those four staffs over something like the Aghanims for AA. Mm-hmm. But like I was saying, okay, here's that Roshan that I was talking about. Once again, really nothing LGD can do about this. So they're going to rotate in, but all things said and done, they're going to give it up for free or they're going to lose some heroes. Those are the two options they have. But, Mushi's going to take a free Aegis here, and then we should see the high ground potential coming out here by DK. And I don't know that there's a lot that LGD can do to stop it.
No, I think they're starting to see this spin out of control. This Rosh is going to give a big signal to them that times are tough right now. They're bunched up. They wanted to try and do something, but honestly, they just don't have the initiation power when the whole crew's standing there in the Rosh pit.
Yeah. This is... I really like, I say this all the time because when this sort of situation comes up and we're casting, and Toffees, you hear me say this all the time too. Mm-hmm. I really hate to ride a team off, especially a team that had such a near comeback as they did earlier, where they were getting so many pickoffs and they had evened out the gold deficit. And it looked like they might be able to get themselves back into the mid game here pretty strong. But we're approaching that 40-minute mark, and it's very difficult to see a strategy that LGD can use to take the lead here, short, barring any big mistakes coming out of DK. So right now, they're giving DK the optimal situation to force mistakes. Mm-hmm. Like, they were moving their king around as much as possible, trying to get an accidental tie out here, an accidental stalemate, but not going to happen as, well, the line goes down, and that is a gem drop. So,
man,
it's not the worst thing in the world, but Ice coming in is going to miss that. AA is going to go down, and
nice arrow.
Now the arrow is going to land on Garter, and Garter is going to take a fair amount of damage as well. Nice stun coming out of the Nyx, and oh, the hook, though. Woo. Oh, wow, that was one heck of a hook, and I think that was actually aimed at 333, but hit the Rubick as it missed the Nyx test and hit the Rubick as he forced Staff away. If that hit its intended target, that is a hook. Unlike any I've ever seen in my entire life.
Yeah,
I mean, the motion blur was still going for the Force Staff when that hit him. I didn't even know that was possible.
No, it was beautiful, and it dropped him right on top of the Nyx for the cogs too. So could not have been executed any better. DK in control of this match, 14,000 gold to their advantage right now. The world is their proverbial oyster, and honestly, after watching this game, these are the guys who I think are going to be the team to beat going into TI, man. I mean, if you didn't think that before, they're just ridiculous. It's amazing how well-coordinated they are.
They're certainly the team to beat for the new Star Cup here. Like, they are obviously a tier one team. They are a global tier one team of the highest caliber, and have been, I mean, all throughout the year and in their previous incarnations have also been a global tier one team, but they're playing in what I think for a lot of – it's really a regional cup. It's really for regional teams. And another way to say regional in a lot of cases for a lot of teams is tier two. Yeah. Right, so a lot of these Chinese teams that they're up against here in the new Star Cup are what we would consider tier two teams for our phrasing in the West, but I think they would consider regional teams.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just so hard for teams like LGD, CDEC to go up against – an all-star pack like this that are playing against the best teams in the world constantly, that have the backbone that DK has in terms of their infrastructure, in terms of the teams they have to scrim. They have an implicit advantage on top of being favored players with favored. Oh, we're actually going to see Mushi go down here potentially. A nice little pickoff. Yep. But it's just an Aegis. And they can't even, as two, they can't even stay and fight him. In fact, the Invoker has to TP away. Mushi is just going to walk out and continue to farm. Meanwhile,
ooh,
in the top lane,
trouble.
Nagasai going to throw out that Siren Song. The Invoker is going to miss the tornado because of it, though. A little bit of miscommunication, but the Siren Song was absolutely necessary. There's a nice two-man stun coming out by 333. Oh, there's a nice shockwave, and that is going to be three down, including the Morphling. And LGD still showing signs of life.
Good play. Nice play, doing that Siren Song, not being afraid, not withdrawing, making sure they brought the entire team in, and executing that very, very well. Will that get them back in this game? I don't know, but was it something that I didn't expect to happen? Yes, it was. I thought for sure that was going to be a tier 3 tower and potentially a Rax as well.
At the very least, they are proving that this is not over. This could be a very long game for us, or for them as well. I mean, we're at 43 minutes. Right about now is when you would expect this to, with the heavy lineups that we have, this is about the point in time when you would expect a victory to start to come out sometime in the next 5 minutes, is when you would expect, like, oh, the writing's on the wall and we're just waiting for the GG. Honestly, a lot of people would say that we're at that point now, but with a Nagasiren, you can never count it out. Even against a Morphling, even against Shadow Fiend, even 12,000, 14,000 gold down, you can just never count it out because she split pushes so hard. And we're seeing that right now. She's going for a heart next, too. She is going for survivability over the ability to kill on this Mushi. Moshi's going to throw the BKB up, but he is going to be netted down. And the Siren Song to escape. Oh, but Ice hookshotting into the sleep.
Wow.
The arrow's there on 333. Are you kidding me? Ice going to force half up and get the cogs. And now maybe he has nowhere to go. She's going to have that pop. She's going to have all of her mana drained as though it makes a difference. Ice going to hookshot her again, and the finger goes out. Talk about the finger. Ooh. That is a big old bird. Telling LGD exactly where they can stick that Nagasiren. They are not through. They're going to hunt down Garter, which honestly is probably the best case scenario for LGD because they're not spending this time pushing. Instead, they're spending this time sort of rafflecoptering around the jungle. So And they don't end up getting Gardner. That out of that situation, that is the best thing that could have happened for LG.
Yeah, it was a great rescue on Mushi in the engagement. They did a beautiful hook shot to make base. I thought it was just going to be a walk away by the Naga Siren and the rest of the posse, but that hook shot re-engages. They get two out of it, and they get the Naga off the board as they prepare to go into the high ground.
All right. So high ground is going to be pushed regardless. There's going to be the glimpse. Long range inside with no vision. Ice gets another hook, and that is an ancient apparition who immediately melts beneath the thunder of the Rattletrap Goblin. All right. And they're going to get the racks. They're going to rotate mid. This is presumably game. The Naga Siren's not up for 15 seconds. Even if she gets up, she's not going to be able to do much about this except Siren Song. And another hook shot coming in and the four staff away. Ancient Apparition going to buy back in time for the Naga Siren to come in here. 3-3-3. Getting caught up in the cogs, so losing a bit of mana, losing a bit of health, trying to get in. The sheep going down and immediate buyback out of the Invoker. They want to stay in this game. They want to get anything they can. There's going to be the retreat coming out of the clockwork and a nice dodge. 3-3-3 going out, but the stun is going to miss thanks to a very timely Black King bar charge.
Yeah.
And the arrow going to go back, hit one of those illusions. So they lose their melee barracks here, but they do manage to, on the back of two buybacks, force DK out.
Yeah,
they don't feel
DK
like they're out.
Out
of this game yet.
They don't feel like it. They lost the bottom racks. They lost the tower. I mean, they're that huge gold drops down to almost the 17K situation. The game is, for all intensive purposes, over. I mean, there's still two tier twos up on the side of DK. That said, though, C-Deck shows us that they deserve to be playing with the big dogs. They're playing very well. They're up against arguably the best team in the world, and they're not letting them run all over them necessarily. They're pushing them out of base. They're doing some good plays, and that's what I think that is really nice to see out of C-Deck. I think that they're going to put up some good performances in the future, especially going into the big tournament.
Yeah. So, all right. Ice coming in here and just trying to clear out these creeps. The Naga Siren's still doing a really good job of doing the split push. I mean, she's got all of her lanes pushed out, which is an advantage that they need. They can't let those lanes get pushed in. As soon as the lanes get pushed in, they're going to get absolutely decimated. But it literally is going to take, like, one creep sauntering on in here. Just kind of lollygagging around, just banging on this building right here. And immediate teleportation in, out of that Morphling means your entire base is dead before you can even react.
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, like I said, this is one of those situations where the pit and the pendulum sort of thing, right? The pendulum swinging back and forth just over the nose of C-Deck, and they know it's coming. They can't yield because it means ultimate death. This is obviously game two. First game went to DK for those of you who are just joining us. Maybe pops that Siren Song. C-Deck wants to come in. Maybe go on Mushi here. He's all by himself.
He does have the BKB, though, and I don't know that there's a lot that they can do to stop him. He is going to throw out his ulti, so he's not going to be able to get out. He is going to be caught down here and Kinesis up. He didn't get the reaction that I think he expected from his team.
No.
I think he thought maybe the Morphling would come in.
Yeah, they were pretty far out of position, to be honest. I mean, he had the 5-second BKB. I think it was 6 at the time he activated. It wasn't going to get him out of that. It was just going to buy him a little bit of time. That said, though, he got the tower, made the creeps more accessible to move in. In the meantime, built some space. Look how far they pushed up that bottom lane in the meantime. And now you've got a whole crew coming in with the buyback from Moosh.
And they just don't really have the damage in any sort of way. Oh, nice hook by Ice. He is going to... Wow. And that is how you exterminate a bug. Anybody who had bed bugs within the recent time, take notes.
Take notes, right? Yeah. And back up to the top, no risk. They want to make sure they get all the racks down. And, I mean, honestly,
GG.
Is there anything? It should be a GG. There's nothing CD can really do to make sure that this thing goes down the way that they want it to.
I have seen comebacks against this sort of deficit, but never in pro play.
And there is the GG coming out of 3-3-3.
All right, so GG called, and DK going to take this series 2-0. We've got a lot more Dota coming out here for another best of three coming up. Next, it's going to be VC Gaming versus Tong Fu. Make sure you stick around for that. My name is Gorgon the Wonderkind. You can catch some of my casting over there on the Twitter at GotCowDota for updates on both casting, analysis, and writing. And, of course, I'm joined by Toffees and, in spirit, by Phage Guy.
And if you like the cast, you can find me at Toffees _Dota2. We appreciate you guys being here supporting what we're doing as we they've been talking about Twitch chat, make our way out of the tier two, trying to get to the light. And we appreciate all the support. But that said, is the next game coming right away or is there a bit of a delay before that one gets started?
There is a little bit of delay. That game is going to be coming up at... Give me just one moment. look that sucker up. It's going to be up in a couple of... I've got to re... Yeah, it's going to be up in about... It looks like an hour, maybe less.
A little less than an hour.
Looks like an hour. Yeah, sorry.
So you heard it here first, guys. It's about a little less than an hour till the game. Enjoy the sound effects from GodGal.
All right, so yeah, it's not a little less than an hour. It's a little less than an hour. All right, I'm going to go ahead and throw over to the lobby, and actually it might be 2 hours now that I'm converting correctly here. So we've got it coming up here in a little bit. I will, of course, hang around the chat and let you guys know what's going on. I desperately need to turn my AC on, though, because it is like a hot box in here. I sit right on top of a vent, so I can't run the AC while I'm casting. Mm-hmm. And I am sweating my gazongas off here, so... We are going to be right into the lobby, and we'll be back a little bit later with some more great Chinese Dota. Stick around.